Next up, I want to cover some very basic debugging techniques. It may seem odd to cover debugging before you even learn the first thing about the code itself, but bear with me. Debugging, as its name implies, has to do with finding the bugs or problems in some code and fixing them. Here you can see one of the first documented computer bugs. It was literally a bug, a moth that had gotten stuck in a mechanical relay. Now, initially, the programs you create will be very simple, and the errors you make will likely be misplaced symbols or misspelled terms. They'll jump right out at you when you take another look at your code, and they'll be easy to correct. But as your programs get more complex, the errors can get more subtle and have more to do with the sequence of actions or some missing step. You're not likely to spot this just by scanning through the code itself. The solution is to be able to inspect what the code is doing as it is running. Fortunately, most browsers now have fantastic developer tools built right into them that help you do this. So when I said a browser is one of the tools you need to develop JavaScript, I wasn't only talking about the ability to be able to look at the final product. The tool set included in the browser actually includes a rich set of debugging tools, very much like what you'll find in high-end developer packages like Visual Studio, Xcode, or Eclipse. With the developer tools, you can write statements in your code that will get logged to a special panel in the browser called the console. Then, by watching the console while your program is running, you'll see the message you wrote, along with any values you might have sent to it. Perhaps you were expecting some value to equal 10 at a certain point in the program, but when you log it, you see that it's actually 9. This can often be an aha moment when you realize where things went wrong. There are even more advanced debugging tools that allow you to pause your program when it hits a certain point. You can then go in and look behind the scenes to see exactly what's going on at that point, and even step through the code line by line and see exactly where things go wrong. We'll cover that kind of advanced debugging in a later lesson. For now, I just want to introduce you to the developer tools, and in particular to the console. We'll be using the console extensively as we go through the parts of JavaScript. So go ahead and open up your browser. Actually, since you're probably watching this online, you most likely already have a browser open. In Google Chrome, to open the developer tools, you can go to the Tools menu and choose Developer Tools, or press Ctrl-Shift-I in Windows, or Command-Alt-I on a Mac. You can also press the F12 key on a PC. These shortcuts generally hold true for other browsers such as Internet Explorer or Firefox as well, but you may need to verify what the shortcut is if you use some other browser in the future. This will open a panel at the bottom of the browser that looks like this. If you've been doing HTML and CSS work, you may already be familiar with this. The Elements tab of this panel shows you the HTML structure of the page currently loaded in the browser. You can select any element and see all of its styles and metrics in this panel here on the right. While doing JavaScript development, you'll mostly be focused on the Sources tab and the Console. The Sources tab shows you all the files that make up the current page. Here you can see index.html and main.js. If you click on the main.js file, you can see the actual code that is loaded into the browser. In lesson 2, I'll show you how to use this tab to inspect and control your code at runtime in order to see what's happening and fix any bugs. For now, we'll be looking more at the console. The console will show you any errors or warnings that occur while your JavaScript program is running. But you can also send your own messages to the console right from within your program. Now, looking back at our main.js file, you recall that I used the alert function to display an alert box. This is often the first thing new JavaScript developers do when they need to debug something. You type in alert, followed by open and close parentheses. Inside the parentheses, you put any message you want to display in the alert box. If you were uncertain that a button was responding to clicks, for example, you could put an alert here, just like I did in this main.js. And this is going to tell you for sure whether or not your button is working. If the alert box didn't show up, you'd know something was wrong right there. Now, while alert works okay for this purpose, it's not really ideal. It's obtrusive and it freezes the web page until you cancel it. Here you can see that while the alert box is open, not only is the web page itself disabled, but the entire browser is frozen. I can't click any of these buttons in the UI or select the URL text or anything. Logging messages to the console works behind the scenes. The program and entire page keep running as usual. Most visitors to the site will never even know that a message has been logged, but it will be right there when you open the console. To see this in action, go back into the main.js file and replace the word alert with console.log. Here, console is a JavaScript object that represents the console tab in the developer tools. You'll learn more about objects in the next lesson. And log is a function on that object. It works almost exactly like alert. You pass it a message by putting it in between the parentheses. So, save that main.js file and open up or reload that index.html file in the browser. Make sure your console is open, and click that button. You should now see the message appear in the console. If you click the button a few more times, you might expect to see the message appear again. But instead, what happens is that a small number appears to the left of the message. This tells you that that exact message has been logged that many times. Sometimes in a program, the same message might wind up getting logged dozens or hundreds or even thousands of times. Rather than make you scroll through page after page of the exact same message, you can just see how many times that particular message was logged. So throughout the rest of the course, you'll be using the console extensively to see how the different parts of JavaScript function and see exactly what's happening in the applications you'll be writing. Finally, I want to show you one more thing about the console. First, let's go back to the code and just change the spelling of console. Spell it with a K. Now this is an error, a typo. There is no object named console with a K. Well, let's see what happens when we run this. Save the file, go back into the browser, and reload the page. Now with the console open, click that button again. Now instead of your message, you'll see another message displayed in red. Mine says, uncaught reference error. Console is not defined. Now you may or may not know exactly what this means, but the part about console not being defined should give you at least a clue. But more than that, look over to the right here, and you'll see this line main.js:2. This means that the error is in the main.js file, and that it's on line 2. Fantastic, it's like having an invisible senior programmer standing over your shoulder, pointing you to the exact line in the exact file where you made an error. So you go back to main.js, and you look at line 2, and you see that you misspelled console. Aha! Set it back to console with a C, and you've done your first bit of debugging. Save it, reload the file, and ensure that it now works again. Now, there's a lot more to debugging than that, but to be honest, many, many developers get by their entire careers using only what I've just covered. I'm going to push you right past all of them in debugging ability by the end of lesson 2. But in the meantime, what you know now will get you very far.